Говорит Москва.
Есть Москва, не цена Дольфа, один пендум.
Faced with a loss of 20,000 jobs in the next year, will the miners be driven into a nationwide strike?
56,000 men in the Yorkshire mining district, the biggest, most elite group of Britain's miners and Arthur Scargill's personal power base, have been called out on strike next Monday.
About 100 miners at Shirebrook Colliery are now ignoring picket lines and going to work.
Well, as Thatcher said herself, we were the enemy within.
The presence of this vast number of police and the horses is not only provocative, it's there to intimidate men. Well, here we're seeing the police state in action. Here is it in red and black and white. Here it is.
They're putting out so much money just to keep these mines going when you don't need them.
His record over the past 12 months means that he ought to have been made redundant any time during the course of that period.
No, he shall pick it no matter what she says, and I'm going to tell you something else if you hope she's watching. I'm going to tell you something else. Tell her this. When we've got pits out, we're going to get stuck back into power stations and give them some humping and get them out. And all these blacklegs are sneaking in now with lorries, taking coal to power stations. I saw them calling. We shall have them and all.
The miners' strike of 1984 was possibly Britain's biggest and most important working class uprising since the general strike of 1926 that happened when Winston Churchill was the Prime Minister. In this documentary, I will not just be relying on books, articles and reports, but I'll also be gathering first-hand information from five participants who were all around during the time of the strike, as they have been generous enough to give up their time to tell us their perspectives of the event. Frankly, you can read as many books as you like, but it's only when you talk to these people that history really just does come alive. The miners' strike began on the 1st of March 1984 when the NCB, or the National Coal Board, which was the organisation that owned the collieries and the pits across the country, had announced that the Cottonwood pit in Yorkshire was going to be closed down, and this caused the miners who worked there to walk out and start striking. This strike then spread across the UK almost a week later on the 12th of March 1984 as the government was planning to close down the coal mines on financial grounds.
Although I didn't like working underground much, I knew that I had to support the strike because we weren't fighting for money, we weren't fighting for anything to make our jobs better, our lives better. We were fighting just to keep what we had. We were fighting to keep our work, and that's what it was all about.
To see the mines being closed down was very disappointing.
We knew that Almond Valley basically, well, especially was a mining town, killed the whole town.
The 1984 miners' strike, which was led by Arthur Scargill and the NUM, or the National Union of Mineworkers, was known by the British ruling class as a mob. Well, frankly, the British ruling class can call it whatever they like, but it is the job of Marxist-Leninists like myself to inject that sort of movement with consciousness. Keep in mind that I will really be focusing on the 1984 miners' strike, although I may briefly mention the miners' strike that happened in the 1970s, which was a strike that some say managed to bring down Ted Heath's Conservative government.
I hope that today's ballot will show that it provides a basis for a settlement and a very early return to work.
This strike was solely about the miners demanding an improvement in their pay and working conditions. So yes, you could say that the miners did win the strike in the 1970s. However, the turnout and the support for the strike that happened in the 1970s was not as massive as the 1984 and the 1985 strike. That was a movement against the closure of coal mines and collieries across Britain. It is said that even today, just over 30 years after the strike, that communities are still fighting, and really, I personally don't blame them, because back then, coal powered approximately 80% of Britain, and the collieries were the biggest employers in the country, especially in what are today some of the most deprived areas of the country, in places like Wales and Northern England. Over 30 years on, however, jobs and employment in these areas are very scarce, and many young people like myself either find themselves moving to Cardiff or even London just to find a decent job. In the late 1940s, there were approximately 100,000 miners working in the collieries of South Wales. By 1984, in contrast, that number of workers had significantly dropped to approximately 20,000. Therefore, it's a very good explanation that for so many communities in my local area, as well as all over the UK, that were destroyed and literally murdered by Thatcher's government, the miners' strike of 1984 and 1985 signified a fight to the death. Police were sent by the British ruling class to go to town on the miners. In many cases, there were police from Yorkshire being sent to Wales and police officers from Wales being sent to Yorkshire. Police officers beat up and arrested striking miners, which definitely explains the evidence as to how and why police officers across the country during the strike received a pay rise from the government. After all, after having a look at Marxist literature just as I was becoming a communist, I have learned that the state, by its very nature, has an instrument of one class to oppress and suppress another class.
I think it's because the Yorkshire police weren't known down here, and most of the local bobbies in this area knew us, and they sent all the local bobbies up to Yorkshire probably to do the same kind of thing up there. So they didn't have any family ties, nothing like that down here then, because a lot of miners' families had police officers in this area, so they were sent elsewhere.
Some of them, personal we know, had actually smirked and told my husband, keep going on strike, and he lifted his fingers and rubbed them together, I'm having money while you're doing this.
Oh, everybody hated the police. They still do, I think. Nobody loves the policeman around here. He's never there when you need him. They're only looking after themselves. They're still doing it. No, today. Well, every police officer around here, it's a small community, we all knew them, who they were, where they were from and everything, and their parents. And also, they were having overtime. They were good money for them. And they were having expenses and everything like that. So they were well away. They were laughing. Margaret Thatcher would give them anything, but left the colliers doing the same.
Half of them were just army boys being put into police uniforms. Because I remember one guy telling me, if in Cynheidre, he went up to Yorkshire Way picketing. And when he was up, he seen his son, and his son was in the army. He was dressed in a police uniform.
But I haven't seen horses that big in all my life, and I remember the first time I was there when they charged us, it was like an earthquake. And, you know, a little valley boy going up there, the closest he's been to a horse is a bloody pit pony. And it was like thunder, all them horses. It was like the charge of the light brigade. It was horrendous, really, really scary. And they held nothing back. The police officers, well, you know, I don't know whether they're police officers or not, but they had them long 6 foot or 5 foot truncheons and they held nothing back. And that's all I'm glad of. Nobody was right in front of one of them horses when they were charging, because they were charging. Because that horse, how nobody got killed, I don't know. But again, you wouldn't see that on the press. You wouldn't see that on the press. But there was a lot of hatred from their side. What the miners, the striking miners, used to do every time the police used to march back and forth, we used to whistle the Laurel and Hardy theme. So I don't know whether that used to wind them up a bit or what.
The class struggle during the time of the 1984 miners' strike was real, very real in fact, because the British bourgeoisie was hell-bent on doing anything to win against the workers, just like they still are today. At the same time, the miners were being sabotaged by trade union leaderships and even the Labour Party. What drove me away from the Labour Party was the objective fact that the Labour Party is not a socialist party. They are a bourgeois social democratic party that only wants to win working people over with concessions. Throughout the UK, pickets were always denied free movement on the roads by the police. There was even sabotage by the courts, who had suppressed funds that were meant to go to the NUM, and even some trade unions like the TUC joined in the bandwagon as well. The sabotage that was committed by the Labour Party and the TUC during the course of the strike was a huge propaganda campaign to try and portray the miners and the NUM leaders as being the ones who caused the violence on the picket lines. Nevertheless, while there were definitely trade unions that were trying to sabotage the NUM, there were also other trade unions that supported the NUM and gave financial support to their cause. But the Conservative cabinet papers that have recently been released show how Thatcher's government was sending agents from MI5 to spy on the miners' unions and catch anyone giving money to the NUM. As well as this, the Department of Health and Social Security, or the DHSS, even sabotaged the striking miners, suppressing their rights to claim any benefits that they would have been able to receive if they were struggling.
And it was hard times then, but because we were supposed to be having some like strike money, and Margaret Thatcher made sure we didn't have that. She even took it out of your social that you were having, if you were having any social at all of them. As far as she was concerned, you could starve yourself to death because of her. And that's what she did in the end. She starved the miners back to the work.
Because we were on strike, we weren't allowed in the money. They weren't allowed milk or nothing like that in school. So it was a bit of a struggle, and if it wasn't for my mother-in-law, my father-in-law, I would have struggled a lot more. That's me. That's due to Maggie Thatcher.
It was brutal actions such as these that really did leave many families, not just here in Wales, but also all across the UK, facing a great deal of hardship, all of which were big contributors to the breakdowns of marriages and so on.
Are you going to be managing?
I don't know, we don't really know. As long as we got a turkey and nice Christmas dinner.
Yes, a bit. And what about the kiddie this Christmas? Is he going to get his Christmas presents?
Well, we got a lot of family, you know, they're very helpful. Mothers and brothers and
whatever.
But presumably it's not going to be as good as last Christmas.
Oh, no. No way.
Are you prepared to keep struggling, though?
Oh, I'm out to the end.
Despite this, however, the striking miners were not left to starve. This was because women, many of whom were the wives of the striking miners, played a huge and very important role in supporting the men on strike. Lots of women across the country set up kitchens and dining facilities, especially for the miners. Not to mention that there were also many women on the picket lines. These facilities were often located in miners' welfare clubs, which can still be found all across the country. In my local area, there are miners' welfare clubs in Ammanford, Broad, Tumble and Pontyberem, to name a few. This is a perfect example of the solidarity working people show for each other in times like these, regardless of gender. And it's something that we should all be very proud of as working people. Lots of women formed groups like Women Against Pit Closures, or WAPC, which was a group that went around and collected money and food for the miners.
We had to walk down to Grisand's Hall in the middle of a heavy snow. It was about 4 or 5 foot snow, with the kids, and walk to the hall where we'd have food passed with butter, sugar, tea and basic foods that had been sent as a charity to the hall, and also clothing for the children. We had to pick out the piles of clothes that had been sent from Belgium and other countries, and also over Christmas time it was very hard. We couldn't afford to buy for the kids. So we had to make and mend, make do with what we had, and we even had toys sent over to the hall in croissants, and the kids were allowed to come with us and pick what they wanted. They were all second-hand stuff, but we thought it was great. We managed, no thanks to Maggie Thatcher.
Oh, the men were quite busy. There were food banks and things like that, and clothes and everything like that. Making sure that their husbands were going to picket lines with food and whatever. They worked hard.
Women still had work, so they were working really hard, and they were trying to support us as well, like in the community as well. So I mean, I know women were working double shifts and things like that in their factories or whatever they were doing. My mother especially, she was working in a factory and she was doing home help as well in the evenings. So I didn't see my mother for hours and hours and hours every day. She'd be working out until about 8 o'clock every night, trying to get a bit of money in to support the family. So it was hard. It was hard.
Oh, I think the miners wouldn't have done half what they were able to do without the women. It was absolutely fantastic. They were as strong, if not stronger, as what the miners were, because it was they brought and kept everything together. What the miners' wives could do with a tin of corned beef was nobody's business, because they could do, and they pulled together, they kept the men together, and they kept the communities together. They made sure that children were right, they made sure they had parties for the children, they organised this, they organised that, they worked together, they travelled all over the country to get support for the miners. They were fantastic, absolutely fantastic. And they still are. Brilliant. I can't say enough about them. They were brilliant. Fair play to them.
There is now a danger that has become a threat to us all. It is a deadly disease and there is no known cure. The virus can be passed during sexual intercourse with an infected person. Anyone can get it, man or woman. So far, it's been confined to small groups, but it's spreading.
The striking miners did not just have a great deal of support from women. Back then, there was also a very negative culture surrounding homosexuality, and being gay or lesbian was considered a shameful act at the time. However, the unconditional support that the homosexual community gave to the striking miners is a strong example of how capable we are as working people to put aside our differences and unite ourselves as one class under one banner against one common enemy, our oppressors, the bourgeoisie.
And an auntie living in London, and she said people were collecting around the markets for the Welsh miners, and some were told they weren't to give, but it was the gay and lesbian people that did support them. Whatever people say about gays and lesbians, they were good to the Welsh miners. And I don't think there's a miner in Wales at that time that have ever forgotten about it. So yes, we do support them now, because they did support us, hundreds of families.
Yeah, I remember the women were going up to London to have assistance and funds, and the gay people were there. It was absolutely fantastic. I remember that the union reps coming down. We used to have a meeting every Sunday either in Garden Club or in the welfare in Ammanford, and they were saying that the gay community were helping us, and it was just unbelievable. And again, you wouldn't see this because the press would stop it.
About 100 miners at Shirebrook Colliery are now ignoring picket lines and going to work. And at first, those miners were able to clock on for the morning shift without difficulty. Pickets were heavily outnumbered by police.
Despite the huge amount of support that the striking miners received from women, homosexuals, and also from other countries around the world, they were a faction of individualistic miners who were outcasted and very much disliked by many miners and their families within communities across the country. This faction of individualistic miners were called scabs. The scabs had really earned their name because when the rest of the miners were out uniting, pulling together, and going on strike, the scabs went to work because they had a bonus from the government for doing so. It was even very common to have someone's son throwing eggs and stones at a bus full of scabs when his father would be sat on that bus as well. Which is quite sad really, but it did happen, and many miners were throwing eggs and stones at their own fathers, and vice versa. The scabs caused a huge split in the strike, and still to this day, over 30 years on, there are still local ex-miners in my area who won't talk to each other because of this, and I can definitely see why too.
Yes, there's a lot of scabs, a good couple of scabs. We all know who they are today. The scab name has never come off their backs, it's still on their backs. Yes, they drink in the same clubs and pubs. But nobody bothers a lot of them because they know they're scabs.
We were skint, we were broke, but we were fighting for a cause and we were fighting for each other. And the scabs, up until that strike, I didn't know what a scab was. But I know now, and I still remember. And I still remember the scabs, and I still know who they are. And it's still very difficult to understand why they've done it. You've had some scabs that would go from day one, they went to work. Okay, that was bad enough. But to me, in my eyes, the scab that went back a week before we all went back, that was the biggest knife that went into my back. To think that we'd gone through that. And a lot of these scabs were on the picket line with me. Were calling scabs, were shouting abuse at the police officers, and you know they were pushing and trying to stop the scabs going into their work, and then to do that, just to go back, and well, I couldn't believe it. And again, Nottingham, North Wales, through any industrial strikes through in the past, they've scabbed. Nottingham scabbed. They've Democratic Union of Mine Workers, DUM. And they proved the point. Where are the collieries now? Where are the collieries in North Wales? So not only the people that went on strike lost everything, they've lost everything as well. British Steel have lost everything. We asked them for support. The railways have lost everything. We asked them for support. No. So, and I don't wish harm on anyone, but I hope even today that they get the odd moment and they hang their head in shame.
It's a difficult one because I wasn't in their shoes. I don't know what kind of... We all had bills to pay. Some people felt as if they had to break the picket lines to get through into work, which I think was wrong anyway.
The youngest brother of all, he was the scab in the family where my father and my other two brothers were standing in the picket line one morning. And they couldn't believe their eyes that my youngest brother was the first one on the bus that morning.
On the 5th of March 1985, the strike was called to a halt and finished. The miners were going back to work. Margaret Thatcher had won, and the pits were then being closed down throughout the 1980s and throughout the 1990s.
Yes, we want to work, and we're having a bit of a talk in the canteen, and tomorrow we want to come to work until having sorted out.
The National Union of Mineworkers shall organise a return to work on Tuesday. We go back together, and as far as we're concerned, this union fights to retain pits, jobs and communities.
Oh, it was nice to go back to work, because it was a hard time without money. built food with a cross.
Well, I went back to work a month early, purely because I was part of the gang laying railway track. We had to make sure that all the railway track was in working order before we got in, before the, you know, full production then. So we had permission from the union to go in to work and just repair any tracks that were broken. So I was lucky in a way, I had a month's more pay than anybody else.
It had come to an end. We tried, we'd failed. And we thought, right, we'll go back to work, but we'll all go back under a banner and we'll go back. Unfortunately for me, when the banners we've been flown were on the morning shift and I was an afternoon shift. So, and a strange thing was, after a year of, well, chaos, and if you want, the time I sat on that spake to go underground and nothing had changed. Nothing. The smell, the atmosphere, the noise, the dust, the stale air, nothing had changed. And it was like, as it happened, has it all been a nightmare? Has it all? And that's what it felt like. It just felt, wow, it was all over. And nothing had changed. Even if they moved the odd pipe out of the way or something, but nothing had changed. And that was it. And of course, and then everybody wanted back what they'd owed you and what this, that and the other. And that's when the hardship really started, was people losing their homes and people. And unfortunately, I lost my house because you just didn't have the funds to repay what you'd owed over the year, because you didn't have nothing.
There is a lesson to be learned from the miners' strike of 1984. That lesson is that British democracy is, in fact, democracy for the capitalist class alone. Yes, there are multiple political parties, but these all represent the bourgeoisie. The policies of the Conservative and Labour parties alike are the policies of business, of private property, of exploitation, and of imperialism. The working class does not have the slightest say in how the country should be run. And whether a bourgeois party is in power or not, it will always work against the will of the working people. The British state is geared towards the armed suppression of the working class, which is very difficult to see in times like now when we are living in relative social peace. But in times like the general strike of 1926 or even the miners' strike of 1984, it's just all too clear. Simply look at the role played by the military in the general strike of 1926 and the role played by the police during the 1984 miners' strike, and you'll know what I'm saying. Therefore, British democracy can be considered as the dictatorship of the bourgeoisie, as it is democratic to the extent that there is democracy for the capitalist class via parliament and various extra-parliamentary bodies. But it's dictatorial in the sense that the capitalist class maintains its exploitative relationship with the working class through means of repression.
I must tell you that what we've got is an attempt to substitute the rule of the mob for the rule of law.
No way!
You're blocking up my right arrest in the legal area.
1984, Great Britain.
Oh, what a lovely summer. Oh, what a long, long strike. But if we have to go through it all again, we would still stand up and fight. Rows and rows of men in blue. It's in miners, they didn't care who.
But Maggie Thatcher, she was the bitch of the strike. And I don't think Collier would even visit a grave today. The only way they'd visit a grave to make sure she was still under there. That's the only thing. Margaret Thatcher said, we're not going to close the pits. And Arthur Scargill saying, you are going to close the pits, you're going to push us all into a corner and close all the pits. Nobody would believe Arthur Scargill, but Arthur Scargill said the truth. It was Margaret Thatcher and the crowd with the liars. I mean the crowd. Well, plus McGregor, he was the Thatcher man. And Margaret Thatcher and the government closed all the pits.
And although it, in one way, it was the worst year of my life, because obviously there was no money, but where friendship and closeness was, it was the best year of my life, because everybody would pull together. And it doesn't matter where you went in the country at that time. You said you were a miner and you were picketing and things like that. The closeness, it was unbelievable, unbelievable. But it was so difficult to get outsiders to understand. Because obviously, like your neighbours that weren't nothing to do with the coal industry, they it was difficult to explain to them because that's all they saw was what the press wanted them to see. But on that front line, it was obvious what was being done. It was just they didn't want the public to turn against the government. They wanted all, well, as Thatcher said herself, and this has chewed and is still chewing on me, we were the enemy within. She said that. It'd just be nice that I could sit down and tell my grandkids and all that all about it, but they would have no idea now. They'd have no idea what Dick, he used to go underground. What for? They'd have no idea. But I hope one day now, by all this information coming out, they can understand that. You know, when they see these film clips of our grief and all that, it wasn't the miners.
Men sacked for refusing to ever cross a picket line. Voices down the IG's warning, never cross a picket line. You must never cross a picket line. Cross a picket line with their wives and children, they stand together. Never cross a picket line. You must never cross a picket line. Look away, look away, look away out west to San Francisco. Look away, look away, look away down south to Sydney Harbour. When the talkers have line. Technically, this is an illegal strike. Never cross a picket line. But technically, workers have no rights. Never cross a picket line. You must never cross a picket line. Never cross a picket line. Where workers' rights are enshrined and written. Never cross a picket line. You must never cross a picket line.